This song this morning is one that I had planned to sing on our fifth Sunday sing night. But since it was in Easter, that got pushed back to the week before. And then it got canceled because our leader, Brother James, was sick. So I said, well, that's all right. I'm supposed to sing a special in a couple of weeks. I'll sing it that day. And then I got to thinking, you know, maybe I ought to add a little testimony to that song. You know, as a young boy, young kid, I had a pretty sordid past, one that I'm not very proud of. In fact, all through high school, I got to running around with the wrong bunch, the West End bunch, if you know what I mean. And they were all older than I was. And that wasn't good either, because I followed along right behind them. Started drinking beer at the age of 13. And that kept on all through high school, and got out of high school, got a little heavier. Pretty soon, in a couple of years, I was addicted to alcohol. I was an alcoholic, in other words. Couldn't hold down a job, couldn't do anything that was right. Spent a lot of time in jails. And I couldn't hold down a job, so I went to work in the oil field. You know, we can work in the oil field and be that way. But it went on like that for several years, and couldn't shake the alcohol habit. Met a young woman, got married. She knew I drank, but she was going to straighten me out. But I don't know how y'all know how an addiction works. You don't straighten it out. It gets a hold of you, and you can't turn it loose. Well, after about 10 years of her living like that, me going from job to job, she come to me one time. She said, Sid, says, I'm going to leave. I'm going to take my kids with me. Well, that kind of hit home. And I told her, I said, listen, I'll quit drinking if you won't leave. And she said, that's a promise? And I said, yes. Well, I did. I quit drinking for about 2 weeks. Because, you know, that alcohol desire in your system, you've got to have it. It becomes a habit. Well, she didn't leave yet, and I went to church one night. Holy Spirit got a hold of me, and I asked the pastor then, I said, pray for me. I don't know what I need to do. Well, that next day on the job, something happened. And this song that I'm going to sing this morning kind of tells the story about what took place when Jesus turn my life around. You've heard a multitude of prayers on my behalf, and I pray one more is not too much to ask. Tried to fight this battle by myself. It's a war that I can't win without your help. Tonight I'm as low as any man can go. Down and I can't fall much farther. Once upon a time you turned the water into wine. Now on my knees I'm turning to you, Father. Could you help me turn the wine back into wine? Many times I've hurt the ones I love. stood by me, but how much can they stand? If I don't put this bottle in your hand, tonight I'm as low as any man. Once upon a time, you turned the water into wine. Now on my knees, I'm turning to your father. Could you help me turn the wine back to water? I shook my fist at heaven for all the trouble I've been through. Miracle from you. Tonight I'm as low as any man can go. Down and I can fall much forward. Once upon a time you turned the water into wine. Now on my knees I'm turning to you, Father. Would you help me turn the wine back into water? Could you help me turn this wine back into water? Oh, yeah. He did it, folks. He did it. The Lord Jesus heard my prayer. And he reached down and he took hold of my hand and he lifted me up out of the miry clay and he set my feet on solid rock. And I'll tell you, folks, he completely changed me. He took the desire for alcohol away. I was a new man. That's the reason that I served him for the next 50 years the best I could, either preaching or singing or teaching or witnessing for him. And you know what? One of my favorite scriptures in the Bible is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And folks, he'll do it for you. Amen. He's still in the miracle working business. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I love you.
Call right now. Hallelujah. I don't need to say anything else. That was good. Thank you, brother. Yes. You should have kept going, man. I'll just sit down and you keep going. I'm serious, man. Yeah, that's good. It's good. Amen. This is what he's saying about. I love how God does this stuff. What he's saying about is exactly what I'm preaching about this morning. Exactly. Hallelujah. That's fantastic stuff. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your message. Father, thank you for aligning things, Lord Jesus. I know, God, that this word is for all of us through this message, through song, through the testimony, Father, and through scripture, Lord Jesus. May we apply it to our lives and may we thank you. Thank you, God, that you are the God of second chances. Father, we love you, Lord, and I pray, God, this morning, God, that you'd speak to our hearts, Father. Challenge us, correct us, show us love, mercy, Father. Show us also, Father, where we fall short, where we need to walk closer with you. Lord, if there's somebody here, let them, Father, make a decision this morning to get a second chance in you, God, and to be able to have eternal life only found in you, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I love going and playing golf with my sons. It's not that I really love playing golf, but I love hanging out with my sons. So when we go out and play golf, every once in a blue moon, I'll hit one, shank one a little bit. Once in a blue moon, About every other shot. But I'll shank one out into the desert somewhere where you can't find it. And if you know anybody that's a golfer, they have something that's called a mulligan. And a mulligan is a redo. It's a do-over. It's something that that you get a second chance on. And so it doesn't go on your scorecard. So you're sitting there, and one of us in our group will shank one, and somebody will say, hey, just go ahead and have a mulligan, you know. Will back there say, go ahead, Brother Jimmy, just go ahead and throw a mulligan down. And so it gets a redo. That redo doesn't go on your scorecard. And so that mulligan that don't go on your scorecard, because it's a redo, it's a second chance, you think to yourself, well, that doesn't seem fair. That doesn't seem right. It's not fair, and it's not right, but it's grace. And it's mercy. And that's the same thing we're talking about this morning. God's grace and God's mercy. Praise God that we don't get what we deserve, but we get grace instead. Amen? Amen. This morning, open up your Bibles, will you please, to Jonah. Preached on a little over 2 years ago, I preached on Jonah. I did a whole sermon series on Jonah. This morning, I'm going to give a completely different take on this the book of Jonah. There's a few things in life that you get second chances on. One of those few things in life that you get a second chance on is, again, if you get a mulligan, or if you play tennis like I do, if you miss on that first serve, you get a second serve. And so there's very few things in life that you get a second chance on. This morning, we're going to read a story. Story that you may have known from a young age as a child. A story that Jonah, it's a type, is what we're going to be talking about this morning. But as Jonah, well, you know the story. Jonah was in a boat, he got thrown overboard. And as he got thrown overboard, imagine that you were in the middle of a sea and you knew you were fixing to die. And then you knew you were fixing to die. You're in the middle of a sea, and you can't only tread water for so long. And here it is, a fish comes up, big old fish comes up and swallows you. And you may be thinking to yourself, man, it's not enough that I just drowned. Now I got to get eaten and drowned? Come on, God. And we've all been in that particular situation, it seems like, that we want to just go do our things, even if it's the wrong thing. And but yet God continues to take care of us and pursue fools anyways. Amen. This morning, right off the bat, Proverbs 28:13. And I forgot to put it up there, but you could write this down on your notes and look at it a little bit later on. Proverbs 28:13, Solomon writes this: he who covers his sin will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. You see, this proverb is all about us getting a mulligan, if you will, a second chance, a do-over, a redo. And that is what we're talking about this morning from the book of Jonah. Jonah, the first chapter, I'm reading from the New International Version this morning. Jonah, the first chapter, as we look at this, Jonah 1:1 says this: the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. As you know, this wickedness had come up, and so therefore the God had set out Jonah to go and complete a task. And we've talked about that at length, and you know the story. I'm not going to dwell upon that so much this morning, other than I'm going to just kind of set the stage. Jonah was set up to go and do a task, but he ran away from that task. Nevertheless, first point this morning that I want to make, ladies and gentlemen, is that God calls. God calls. That's the very first thing that has to happen, is God has to call. If God doesn't call, we don't have anything. God has to call us. God has to call you into repentance. God has to call you, has to reach out to you, has to elect you, whatever that word you want to use, predestined, whatever you want to look, you look at it. When you look at Scripture, you can't refute that God calls. God's the one that God stirs you in your heart. When God calls, then you have a chance, you have a choice, right, to make that decision. But God has to be the one that calls, I believe. In Scripture, the Lord came to Jonah and tells him, he calls him, right? Second point, real quick this morning, is Jonah, he runs away. Verse 3 says this, but Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed to Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Joppa is, right now is just Joppa or Jaffa. It's the same port. It's just above Tel Aviv. Carol and I spent the night there in Joppa a couple of years ago. This is the port, the same port that they would float from the King Tyr, would float down the cedars from down for the temple for Solomon. This is the same port that they would use for that. This port is where all the ships would come into. This port there, Joppa, is where Jonah jumped off and wanted to go to a different way. You see, God says go this way. Jonah wants to go that way. Honest to goodness, if it is as opposite could be. Ladies and gentlemen, you can't run away from God without consequences. Can't run away from God without consequences. You see, we already established this earlier that God calls, when God calls you and you hear the word of God, you can't run away from God without consequences. If you really know God in your life, that means that God will keep calling you and calling you. You could run away, you could try to hide, but God will keep calling in His time. And you could feel God calling. Where do you feel God calling at? It's down in your spirit. You know, how many times have you've been uneasy about something? God has maybe told you to do something, or God has called you to do something. As God spoke to you, you're a little uneasy in your spirit. You're restless. That's because you were not obedient to the call of God. And when you're not obedient, you're going to have that restlessness. If you were a child of God, if God has called you and you heard God's voice and you are disobedient, there's consequences. And you're going to have that consequence in your life. And you're going to have that disconnect in your life where you're going to feel not right inside. You may say to me this morning, hey, Brother Jimmy, okay, look. Pastor, I've not ran away this way to this way. You see, we run away daily, though, from God when we don't spend time with God. When we don't read Scripture, when we don't pray, when we don't think about God, we are running away from God. When we don't allow God to be a part of our day-to-day lives. You see, life gets so busy and we go and we do all of our things. And our things is what the world thinks tells us to do. And all the worldly things that tells us to do certain things, we are walking away and getting away from God. And so we, in a sense, are exactly like Jonah, going in a opposite direction. Sometimes when we do that, we say, well, I feel so dry. I don't feel God in my life. Well, that's because we are going in the opposite direction. That's exactly what Jonah did. Jonah was trying to flee from God. God had given him a message, had told him to do something. Now he's running away from God. He's trying to get away from God. When we try to get away from God, when we don't pray, we don't read our Bible, maybe we don't come to church, maybe we don't seek God, or what about this one? What about when we try to do things on our own? Boy, I'm good at messing that one up, are you? Trying to do stuff on our own. You know, I've told you this several times before. There's a lot of new faces. Let me tell you this again. That I have learned the hard way that every time I need to do anything mechanical-wise or things around the house, I pray and I ask God for some direction first and foremost. I do that all the time. You know, I'm not exactly, Mr. Goodwrench, but I can get things done. It just takes me about four times longer than everybody else. Don't say amen, Carolyn. That's okay. We still love you. I'm not exactly Bob Vila. I could do stuff around my house, but again, four times as long as somebody else. I can figure it out, though. But this is what I have figured out, is every time when I do these kind of home projects that miraculously pop up, and you know they pop up at the most horrendous time, that I must pray to ask God for wisdom. And I believe that we ask God for wisdom on all things, for our day-to-day lives in all things. I went through the hard way whenever I was putting in a hot water heater and ran into some issues because it was elevated and the gas line and the flue at the top, everything was just not working. And those of you guys that have worked with a hot water heater before, and when you're trying to take the old one out, that water goes a little bit everywhere. Even when you think that you have done it correctly, you find out pretty soon that it's not correctly. And so as I put the new one in and my boys were helping me, and it was a long, drawn-out process. It was four times as long as it should have been. But yet when that pilot would not light, I was like, I did everything correct. I went and checked the gas line again. I did everything. The exciter on the brand spanking new water heater that cost $2,850, but it was on sale for $20, right? That excited on that. I could not do that. And I kept piddling with that thing over and over and over again. And I got the little flame, the exciter part out, and I did the emery cloth over it. I tried everything I could do to fix that. To the point where what I did after that is I dawned on me, I forgot to pray. And I know it sounds frivolous, but I'm telling you, as sure as I'm standing in front of you, I prayed and I said, Lord, can you give me wisdom? He showed me exactly the part that I had backwards at that particular time. I fixed it. That sound, it's a brilliant sound when you've been at that for a long time. And you see that calling for heat and it's actually giving it there. And then I thought, I messed up. And so every single time we have projects now and I do all my own stuff, because I'm a tightwad, yes. But when I do all my stuff, I pray. I pray. And God shows me on how to do things. So whenever I believe at the smallest thing in our lives that we ask God for direction. We can't run away. When we run away, there's consequences. So the consequences of running away. Let's continue on in Scripture. The fourth verse down here from the NIV version. Jonah 1:4, consequences of running away. Verse 4, then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God. And they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten up the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he had laid down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, how can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so that we will not perish. You see, Jonah's ongoing sleep was perhaps induced by God to maybe advance the crisis to the point where it was clear that the sailors, that their God could not help. Jonah may have thought when he got this message too, you wanted me to call on my God? You don't understand, I'm running away from him. I'm going the opposite direction. You wanted me to call on my God? You don't understand. But God, although he's running away, although Jonah is running away, God has not stopped pursuing Jonah. Praise God that when you and I run away, that God does not stop pursuing us. When we don't read scriptures, when we don't pray, when we don't think of God in our day-to-day lives, when we don't bring him to be a part of our day-to-day lives, when we're going off and we're doing our own thing, praise God that he does not give up pursuing us. Let's continue on in scripture here. Verse 7, the sailors said to each other, come, let us cast lots to find out who was responsible for this calamity. They cast lots and it fell on Jonah. I want you to understand here, God even used pagans for his purpose. God can use all things for his purpose. Let's continue on in scripture. Verse 8, so they asked him, tell us, who's responsible for making all this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What's your country? What people are you from? He answered, I'm a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Jonah was a Hebrew. He knew from his past who God was and what God could do. I want you to think about that this morning. I told you this last week, and as God has really been pressing upon me upon this, is God uses all your past, all the things that God has poured into your life and showed you and taught you. The track record that you have with God is what you can always rely upon in the future. So when you go through those tough times, when those storms of life are hitting your boat pretty hard and it looks like it's falling apart, and you've tried to do everything you can to lighten your load, you've thrown that cargo out there, you've lightened the load as much as you can, and you still haven't accomplished anything, understand that all the time that you spent with God in the past, you can rely upon that, because God continues to bring those things to mind. Even right now, I'm talking about that, think about that. Were some times in your life and your past, as difficult as it may be, that you could say, God, you were there. God, you were there. And you're thinking about that time right now, and it, if you think about it, you takes you back in time where, God, you were there. Even amidst that horrible event that took place, God, you were there. You were there. Jonah is in his own horrible place. And even in his own horrible place, because he had heard God, because he once used to walk with God, he knew God, and so therefore, God was still pursuing Jonah. Praise God that God still pursues his children. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God for that. As we continue on here in Scripture, we see here and read here in Scripture that when in verse 10, this terrified them and they asked, what have you done? They knew he's running away from the Lord because he'd already told them so. So in verse 11, the sea was getting rougher and rougher. So they asked him, what should we do to make the sea calm down for us? Pick me up and throw me in the sea, he replied, and it will become calm. So I know that it was my fault that this great storm has come upon you. Throw me into the sea. Jonah was even willing to die in his rebellion. Jonah was even willing to die in his rebellion. Talk about stubborn. And you think your spouse is stubborn. No elbowing right now, all right? But Jonah says, pick me up and throw me in. So instead of crying out to God that he was fleeing away from, instead of trying to not go in this direction, but instead of trying to right the ship, so to speak, and go from this direction to this direction, instead of saying, all right, Lord, I'm running away from you. I need to walk and run towards you. Even in his own rebellion, even if he was running away and trying to get away from God, he still was stubborn and says, look, throw me overboard. Throw me overboard. Throw me into the sea. I'd rather die. Let's continue on in verse 13. Instead, the men did their best to roll back to land, but they could not, for the sea even grew wilder than before. Then they cried out to the Lord, please, Lord, do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man, for you, Lord, have done as you pleased. Then they took Jonah, verse 15, and they threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. You see, it was apparent to the sailors that Jonah was the one that offended God. They were scared to death to throw him overboard. But God even so showed those stubborn sailors that were following pagan God who the real true God is. And even in their rebellion, or even as Jonah rebelled and when they pitched him over, and God caused the sea to grow calm, then they got a lesson that day. And it says here that they made a change.
Ladies and gentlemen, God can change all people. All of us means me and all of you. No matter if we follow different things, if we follow a different whatever, we could go out and be in rebellion. We can go out and walk away from God. We can do all these things. But when you turn your heart to God, God loves you. When you turn your heart to God, God can save you, every single one of you and me. And that's a praise. That's the God of second chances. Fourth point this morning. God wasn't going to give up on Jonah. Chapter 1, verse 17 says this: Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. God controls all these things. God controls this big fish. It's going to come and swallow. Everybody says it's a whale. When you read the scripture, it just says a big fish. God sent this big fish to go and swallow up Jonah. Now check this out. In chapter 2, Jonah, he gets thrown overboard. As he gets thrown overboard, he's like, okay, I'm going to die. I am running away from God. This is it. And as he's running away from God and he thinks this is it, and he drops down underneath that water, and then God provided a miracle. A big fish comes up and swallows him. Now, do you think that Jonah thought that was a miracle at the time? Not even close. He's thinking, God, I can't even do anything right. Have you been there? You thought to yourself, God, I can't even do anything right. I just want to die and get this over with. I can't even do that right. Maybe some of us have been there. I think we all have. Where it seems like that no matter what you have done, even it seems like the simplest thing, you can't even do that right. And God's saying, look, I'm not finished with you yet. I'm trying to teach you. And if you will open your heart and your eyes, you'll be able to see what I have for you. But in that despair, in that anguish, and let's be honest with our bullheadedness and our stubbornness, we say, I can't even do this right. And you cry out to God that way. And God's saying, look, just take a deep breath and praise God that you can breathe. Because when you are able to take a deep breath, Jonah, in the belly of a fish, was able to take a deep breath. Not one deep breath, not multiple, for 3 days and three nights. He's able to breathe. You see, God provided and afforded him a miracle. Because God is the God of second chances. Thank you, Jesus is right. So as he was swallowed up by the fish, the God of second chances. Now, the fifth point I want to make this morning is the God of second chances. You know, I could do a whole sermon series probably for a whole year about what Scripture says in the Bible about how the God that God had gave these people second chances. Let me just go through a few in Scripture. Jacob in Genesis cheated Esau, his brother. He cheated him out of his inheritance, but God gave Jacob a second chance. Moses murdered an Egyptian. God gave Moses a second chance. Rahab was a prostitute. Rahab was not doing things that was something would be anybody would be proud of. Rahab was given a second chance, and as a matter of fact, Rahab is listed in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Rahab got a second chance. Samson. Samson wasted his life on women and got thrown in prison and everything else. Samson got a second chance. David committed adultery. David basically committed murder. David says in Scripture he was a man after God's own heart. Why? Because his heart was for God. David got a second chance. Peter Peter denied Christ not once, not twice, but three times, exactly like Jesus Christ told him. And Jesus gave Peter a first, second, third chance. Paul persecuted Christians. Paul got a second chance. I want you to do this right now. Put your name in this blank. God given a second chance, a third chance, a 1,000th chance, a 1,000,000 chance, a 1,000,000,000 chance. God has given you second, third, multiple chances. That is a praise. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God for that. The second chapter, verse 10, it says, the Lord commanded the fish to vomit Jonah out on dry land. The third chapter, verse 1, and I want you to underline this in your scripture. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. A second time. You see, ladies and gentlemen, you and I serve the God of second chances. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time and tells him the same thing that he told him the first time. God gave Jonah a second chance. It says here in this time in verse 2, it says in the third chapter, verse 2, go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim the message that I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and he went to Nineveh. Before we clown on Jonah too much, understand that you and I are hard-headed and we rebel as well. And praise God that he does not give up on us. But he keeps pursuing you. He keeps loving you. And as you, as a child of God, you cannot sin enough where God does not still love you. You can't do anything in life to make God love you anymore. You can't do anything in life to make God love you any less. As a child of God, God loves you. And you need to hear that. Second chance is what Jonah got to do. The Syrians there in Nineveh, they got a second chance. God had compassion upon the Assyrians as well as Jonah. God has compassion upon you and I. We can't do it on our own. So God gave us a second chance to love him. We can't do it on our own, so God gave us a second chance to follow him. We can't do it on our own, so God gave us a second chance to live for him. God is giving you and I a second chance. And this is what I say. Praise the God of second chances. The God that gives us mercy and does not give us what we deserve. Praise our God of second chances, a God that God does not give up on us. Praise Jesus Christ, his holy name. The God of second chances is a God that speaks to you this very morning, 2024. That same God still calls and still calls. And that call that he gives you and he reaches out to you, we can't reject. Because if we reject, there are severe consequences. If the Assyrians and Nineveh would have rejected that call, they would have been annihilated. If Jonah did not do exactly what he was supposed to be doing, who knows what would happen to Jonah after that. Ladies and gentlemen, God calls to you and I, but if we do not hear that call, then there is no heaven for you. That's a tough thing. But as God calls and gives us second chances and third chances and 1,000,000 chances, then praise God for that. If you have once given your life to Christ and you have maybe backslidden, you've gone away from God. God's saying, come home. Come home. change some things in your life and come home. But you got to come back to God first, and then you worry about cleaning stuff up. You don't clean stuff up and then go back to God. It doesn't work that way. God says, look, let me take care of you. Let me have you in the palm of my hand, and then we'll work on circumcising your heart. We'll work on changing your heart. We're working on changing your life and those kind of things. But you have to give your life to me in the palm of my hand first. God is here this morning. The God of second chances is here this morning. And he's given many of us this morning a second chance. And praise God, if you have received Christ, if you've given your life and he's given you all these extra chances, because guess what? We do this a lot. Then what I want you to do this morning is to praise God, to thank God for the God of second chances and giving you what you don't deserve, but giving you mercy and grace instead. Mm-hmm. And on your scorecard at the end of the day, whenever we go to heaven, because of the blood of Jesus, the blood that dripped out of Jesus, I like to look at it this way, the blood that dripped out of Jesus covered the book that has all my sins in it. The blood of Jesus covered my sins and blotted those out. He blots out your sins. But you have to have that relationship with Christ. That's the only way that your sin is covered. The God of second chances is calling. Are you listening? This morning, let's stand. As Brother Sid, his message this morning through song was so, so important. How his life was changed 50-something years ago because of allowing God to make a difference in his life. Look, when you give your life to Jesus, it doesn't mean there's going to be a bed of roses. It's not going to be just a red carpet thrown out there and everything's going to be good. That's not what the deal is. What the deal is this: you give your life to Jesus and God forgives you of your sins and helps be a friend unto you as he walks through your life day to day. Put your hand in the Master's hand this morning. Thank God for second chances. The altar is open if you need to come pray. I'm here if you need to come and pray with me. As God calls, thank him for his chances and thank him for loving you. If you've never placed your hand in Jesus's hand, you come this morning. Let your life be changed as a result of you either accepting Christ or rededicating your life to Jesus Christ. This morning, you come as we sing.